But I don't feel like my life is any different than someone else's, because God's word says that he knows our days before the foundation of the earth, and so I want to live today as if it is my last, just like everyone else should be living their life today as if it is their last. And if it's not, then what a blessing that we get tomorrow.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, in February, what's the big holiday?
Well,
I hope you remember.
Valentine's Day.
That's right.
I didn't miss it. Always nice and usually time delayed, just for convenience.
Here's one that's a little tougher. It's also National Heart Month. Did you know that?
That's a nice coincidence.
Yeah, so one's on the emotions and spirit, and the other one's on the physical heart.
That's good.
But today, we want to talk about both of those with our guests, and our guests have some great insights about their journey and what God has done, both for their physical heart as well as their emotional and spiritual heart. Mm.
Julie and John Manning are with us. Julie is a mom and a pediatric nurse practitioner, and she and John have three boys, Noah, Hunter, and Joshua. And there's a riveting story here that Julie has captured in her book, My Heart, Every Beat Surrendered to Our Unchanging God.
Yeah, John and Julie, welcome to Focus.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
What an amazing thing. Now, we're going to unfold this story, obviously, but when we look at you coming together as a couple, describe who you were, what God was doing in your lives. You went to Texas A&M. I was just down there a couple months back. You met there, right?
We did. We were friends then. John was quite goofy at the time, and I...
Why did you struggle to get that out?
A little bit of a class clown.
Okay.
And I was that studious girl that lived more hours in the library than hanging out socially.
So you guys are moving along. You catch each other's eye. You end up courting and getting married, right?
Eventually, 6 years after college.
Six years after? Mm-hmm. Okay. Somehow, John, you convinced Julie that you were the one. I'm not even going to unfold that story. It just worked out. Let's call it a miracle.
That's right.
And you both said yes, and you got married. And then you had a miscarriage.
Mm-hmm. We did.
And I'm sure that was very difficult. Here at Focus, we hear from a lot of you, the listeners, who have gone through something similarly. Emotionally, touch on that, and then let's move to your second pregnancy and the birth of your second child. Put that together for me. What was happening in your mind and heart, the loss of a baby, and then becoming pregnant again, the fears of that. Describe that for our listeners.
I think that when we became pregnant the first time, you know, as a woman, you just kind of jump to motherhood. You get the positive pregnancy test, you go see the heartbeat for the first time, and you're like, I'm going to be a mom. And you just, your brain goes there, your heart goes there, your capacity to love just grows. And then with the loss of, you know, our child, it was really the first time that John and I mourned together over something, and it allowed us to journey through relying on the Lord together in such a beautiful way that I think suffering sometimes can either pull us apart or draw us together. And God really used that scenario and that circumstance to draw us together in our marriage, rely on Jesus, rely on His word for hope and for comfort.
And it obviously, because you tried again with Hunter, complicated pregnancy, it sounded like. You had a C-section. Tell us about that.
Yes. So when Hunter was born, we had a scheduled repeat C-section because our first child was born via C-section. And so our doctor wanted to, you know, do a surgery to get Hunter out. And from that perspective, we were fine with that decision. And so, you know, when we woke up that morning to go meet Hunter for the first time, we were kind of like, we've been there, done that. Like, we know what to expect. We know how it's going to go. And fortunately or unfortunately, it went very differently than we had expected it would go.
Describe how.
Well, they had prepped me for the surgery, and then John came in and was standing by my side. But in the middle of, you know, Hunter being taken out and delivered, just everything in the operating room went fuzzy for me. I felt lightheaded. I felt dizzy. I felt as if the physician and the surgical staff and the anesthesiologist, all of their voices were just blurry and kind of echoing in the the background. I couldn't really comprehend exactly what
So baby was fine, but mom
baby was
not.
Fine. And so because I had worked in an ICU for so many years, my first instinct is to look at the cardiac monitor when I don't feel very well, because I'm like, what's going on? And I looked over and every other heartbeat was an irregular heartbeat. And then I went into a period of where I had multiple irregular heartbeats all in a row. And with my training, I was like, that's a rhythm. That's not a good heart rhythm. And they might start CPR on me, and then
so all this
I,
is
I black out.
Flashing through your mind as you're on the bed, just giving birth, in essence, through C-section to Hunter. But as you're going out, this is your thought process.
And that's the my inputs coming in.
John, where were you at that time? Were you in the delivery room?
And well, when they do a C-section, you know, I don't have to coach breathing or anything like that. But they I'm in a waiting room, and then they'll come get me. I like to say as they're rounding third.
Right.
So just as Hunter is going to be born, and as they're kind of wrapping up the surgery, they'll bring me in so I can be there and be present. So as I walk in, I don't have Julie's training, so I'm not looking at the cardiac monitor. I'm not really picking up on anything other than kind of squeezing Julie's hand and kind of seeing the action as Hunter is coming out, just being excited, being in a place of excitement and anticipation.
Right.
I didn't necessarily understand kind of the gravity of the situation or what was going on.
So what happened the next few moments? What when Julie passed out, what did the doctors do? Where did they go? What happened?
So I get to go with Hunter to the nursery and kind of see him get his, they clean him up a little bit and weigh him. And so I get a few moments with him as they're, I said, closing up Julie from the C-section and doing some of that stuff. So I wasn't necessarily aware of what they were doing with Julie, but they called the cardiologist who was at the hospital during the on call or whatever to come in and, you know, take a look at her levels and kind of figure out what needed to happen in light of what transpired in the middle of the.
So you're still not totally aware of what's going on.
No, I mean, the anesthesiologists understood what was going on because they're trying to track everything going on with Julie. And
the end of it was is that they didn't need to start CPR on me that day. My heart spontaneously came back into a regularly irregular rhythm, to say that. But when I passed out, I came to a point where I was just in a place of being covered by light and warmth. And going from a place that I felt covered in peace to the point that I could feel physiologically, I could feel not every blood vessel, but I felt blood vessels down in my legs dilate and just create this warmth over my body. And then the next thing I know is that I feel a lot of shoving on my shoulders, and I hear the anesthesiologist going, "Are you okay? I need you to open your eyes. I need you to open your eyes." And I didn't want to open up my eyes. And so that went on in the midst of John being called over to, you know, meet Hunter, care for Hunter and all of that. And so I'm not sure what medically they did for me that day other than kind of take a deep breath that it didn't progress to anything more serious.
Mm. Our guests on Focus on the Family today are Julie and John Manning, and Julie has written a book capturing this story, and we're only partway through it. The book is called My Heart, and we'll encourage you to call 800-A-FAMILY or stop by focusonthefamily.com/broadcast to get your copy.
So, Julie, this is the red flag. I mean, obviously, they noticed something was wrong with your heart. This is the first time in your life that you knew. Being a marathon runner, in shape, through college, your career, now something's going to be different, and you begin to follow up with the cardiologist. What is he or she telling you at that point?
So the day of Hunter's birth, they did a lot of testing that day, and they ended up saying, you know what, I bet this was just the stress of the surgery. Your heart, from all the other testing that they did, your heart looks relatively normal, so we're just going to allow you to keep your baby in your room with you, and we'll see you up for follow-up 6 weeks later. And so over that ensuing 6 weeks, when, you know, we bring Hunter home from the hospital, we're getting used to being parents of two young children under the age of two, and
you're recovering from C-section.
Recovering from a C-section, and, you know, trying to, you know, get back into some sort of shape after being pregnant. And I just started having symptoms of feeling short of breath. I would get lightheaded when I took a warm shower, and it's kind of bad being a nurse because you know just enough information, but you don't know what you don't know.
It's like going to WebMD.
Exactly. Exactly. Let's just Google my symptoms. It'd be perfect. and so I thought, oh, I'm just dehydrated. I'm just tired. I'm out of shape. So I wasn't taking my symptoms seriously. But then I follow up with my cardiologist 6 weeks later, and we do some more testing. They did an ultrasound of my heart. And that day was the day that I found out that my heart was actually failing and it was only functioning at half of normal. Hmm.
How did you process that? I mean, that's a big diagnosis. That's life-threatening, obviously. Mm-hmm. And how old are you at this point now? You're early 30s.
32.
Yeah. So how are you processing that with John? John, how are you processing it? And where's God in all of this as you pray? Mm-hmm. Lord, what's happening?
I think time stood still. A lot of denial at first. Like, this can't be happening. This can't be me. I'm a go-getter. I'm healthy. I've eat right. I exercise. I'm doing all of the right things per the worldly standards. Like, this seems so odd. And like, why is this happening? And so I know that time stood still that day, that we learned it. And then I kind of flipped over into medical mode and was like, okay, these are the steps we need to take. She called in medicine for me. I started my medicine, did regular follow-ups. And I think I disassociated myself from processing things emotionally to just intellectually trying to get through those first few months of what does life look like now. Hmm. And so not that I distanced myself from the Lord in it all, but I kind of was like, Lord, I need you right now. I can't do this on my own. It was very humbling for me, being like the type A go-getter, achiever personality, to being like, wow, everything, like, feel like my life kind of got turned upside down with all of this.
And I'm sure all that upheaval, of course, you have Noah, your firstborn. At this point, you're having to teach him, I think, by the age of two, how to dial 911, just mm-hmm. in case, John, I guess you're out of the house and you're having some kind of cardiac issue. Mm-hmm. I think it's that, for the listener and for us too, it's that question of how to live with this day in and day out, that you don't know, mm-hmm. you have no certainty of your next heartbeat. Mm-hmm. I mean, that in itself is stressful.
Yes.
And ends up creating a lot of concern. How did you just manage that day to day, that you weren't sure if you're going to be alive?
There was several months of my life where I asked a lot of what if questions. You know, what if I'm pushing the jogging stroller and I collapse on the road and I'm by myself? Or what if it happens while I'm driving the car? You know, when John would leave for work in the morning, is this the last time I'm going to kiss him goodbye? So I lived in these what if sad scenarios that were actually reality. They weren't like, you know, several weeks after I found out that I was in heart failure, I also went in for a procedure and learned that I was at risk for a sudden cardiac death. And they actually had to shock me several times to bring me back. And so they put a defibrillator in me. So these what if scenarios were not unrealistic questions to ask, but it certainly caused my brain to spiral down into a state of depression and sadness and darkness, and I didn't know how to climb my way back out of that.
And that's somewhat normal for heart patients, particularly, to be in that spot where it becomes overwhelming. How did you manage that with your faith? What practical ways did God intervene for you to give you confidence, to give you a sense of hope for tomorrow, even though you have these physical issues that you're dealing with?
Well, one, he used my husband. John would bathe me in the Word. And so John would pray, and John would speak God's truth over me. And the Lord really used our community as well. Mm. So whether it was, you know, receiving scripture on my phone via email or notes written left on our doorstep, God pursued after me. I don't want to say that I pursued after God in the midst of it, but God really pursued after me. And I couldn't escape his word, because his word kept coming at me from all different directions, whether it was through John or our community and our friends and our church.
I'm kind of a glasses one-eighth full type of guy. and so since I maybe didn't understand the significance. It wasn't completely like ignorance is bliss, but I tried to avoid thinking through those worst case scenarios for Julie and her heart. I just believed that God was going to heal her. I believed that it was going to be okay, regardless of the outcome.
Yeah, let me ask Julie, because again, people who are walking through this kind of thing, and I really want to hear from you as the wife. Mm-hmm. Did John manage that part well, or did it concern you, or did you feel like he doesn't grasp always what's going on? What things did you hide from John because you were afraid?
I think I hid how deep in the darkness I really was from him. Because I love him so much, and I, desire his approval, and I desire to please him from just a standpoint of our relationship. Like, one of my faults is I just don't want to let him down. Like, that's devastating for me if I let him down. So that's one of my faults. But
in this case, so let me press you a little bit, because I appreciate the heart of that. Yeah. But I mean, these are things that are well beyond your control. Mm-hmm. It's not like you created a damaged heart.
Sure.
So how did you reconcile that as you're trying to be that incredible spouse to John? But still, it's not your fault. Did you come to that conclusion that, okay,
I
can't control it?
Yes, absolutely. And I think the turning point for us and me allowing him in was going, we had tickets to go to an A&M football game, and we brought our boys.
It all comes back
to
that.
Always have to accept.
But we were on a road trip, so we had to drive the 2 hours to the game, and in the car, like, we actually had uninterrupted 2 hours of time to talk. And that's just that day that I just kind of
opened up
and let everything out and felt.
Would you describe that, just so I understand it, would you describe that as you allowed John to see the things that you feared, the things that concerned you? And then John, right, the next obvious question is how did you feel and how did you respond? Did it scare you?
I wouldn't say it scared me, because by the time that happened, it was almost like, this is how I felt. This is where I was. That wasn't where she was right then. And so in some ways, Julie and I have talked about this. I didn't get a chance to encourage her in certain ways, knowing just where was her unbelief? How was her hope failing? What were the fears and the lies that she was believing? But I think in God's providence, like, her not sharing those things with me in some ways allowed for me not to join her in that. Like, it gave me a place to stay hopeful and optimistic and encouraging of her. I think the word that we used was kind of steadfast, that I was not going to go to those places. I was going to continue to kind of put my hope in the fact that God was going to work through this regardless of the outcome. So when she shared those things, and again, I didn't want for her, I mean, she felt bad that we couldn't have another child. She felt bad. I mean, there's all these things she felt bad about. And I'm like, babe, no, like, you don't need, I'm so thankful for you and for God's will over our life. There is no way that you are disappointing me.
Did that feel honest when he responded that way?
Mm-hmm. It did.
And it gave you a concreteness to his attitude and his outlook and his love for you, right?
Yep.
See, that's a great lesson right there.
Yeah, it is.
Sometimes we fail to, as husbands particularly, to understand that type of expression means the world to our wives.
Well, and we've been studying our church, the book of 1 Peter, and it talks about husbands living with their wives in an understanding way or according to knowledge. And so what are the ways that I can better understand Julie, her physical condition, but then also emotionally, where is she at? How is God teaching her? Where is she learning? How can I encourage her, even press into her, and challenge her to put her hope fully in God's grace?
Well, and that's a good word, because again, eventually your heart does fail. Describe that day. How old are the boys? What was the circumstances? What took place?
Mm-hmm. So I was doing part of this program. It was a development discipleship type program at church, and one of our assignments was to kind of share our testimony and share what God has been doing in our lives over the last year. And so fast forward, you know, 15 months. So now Hunter is 15 months old. Noah had just turned 3. And it was my opportunity to share what God had been teaching me over the last year of, like, the Lord bringing me out of this place of depression and how God was working in our marriage and bringing unity and just togetherness in our marriage and encouragement. And so this Sunday morning, I shared just all of this, just kind of laid it all out there, was bare, was vulnerable with these group of ladies. And it was so freeing to be able to confess all of that and at the same time be encouraged by what God had been doing and kind of seeing, looking back in hindsight, how far the Lord had increased my faith and my desire for Him. And
must have felt like an oasis, really.
It was
like a drinking in of that great water.
Mm-hmm.
But what happened?
So we finished that morning, and John had to leave to go to our other church campus for some responsibilities, and so I went to go pick up the boys from the nursery to just take them home after that service. And while I was walking to get Noah, I started feeling pressure in my neck and in my chest and was like, oh, this feels tight, this feels weird. So I started to try to breathe more calmly, and I went to go pick up Noah, and I signed him out. And, you know, when you have a 3-year-old, they don't ever, like, stay next to your side. They always just run off and are, you know, you have to, like, chase after them to go get them. And that day, Noah held my hand. It was so uncharacteristic, all the way down the hallway and around the corner to another hallway to pick up Hunter. And by the time I got to Hunter's room, I just did not feel well at all, to the point that I asked the nursery folks, I was like, can you help me get them buckled in the car seats? Because I don't think I can
get them buckled.
But I'm okay. I can drive home. It's fine.
Oh, yeah.
But by the time, I mean, I remember signing my first name and then halfway through signing my last name to sign him out, I was like, no, I'm going to collapse the ground. And I pointed. It's so typical of Julie. I was like, you need to call 911 and you need to call my husband. And I handed them my cell phone and then I dropped to the floor.
Oh, my goodness.
They
must have panicked too. What, you know, that's unusual.
That and in front of like 25 toddlers and my own children. Like that was one of my worst fears, is collapsing in front of my kids.
Oh.
And so, but that day I had suffered a heart attack. And so 911 was called and EMS came and got me and rushed me to the hospital. And
I mean, that it's interesting and overwhelming emotionally to think about a young couple with kids that are now 10, 8, and 3. You adopted your third.
Yes.
Because being pregnant again would be too much stress, I think, is the story unfolding. But, Julie, in that regard, give us an update. How are you doing today? And then I want to just close with where people are at generally. It may not be their heart that's suffering, but they're suffering in some area, and I want to talk about that to give people hope, and the hope that you have today.
Sure.
So how are you two doing? How is your heart? How are the boys? What's every day like?
I'm technically back in the heart failure range again. So over the years, I've, you know, my heart has improved some, and then it's dropped a little bit, and then it's improved some. And this past May, I found out that I'm technically in that heart failure range again. And so it's just another one of those opening your hands and surrendering, going, okay, God, you have my life. Every, you know, I can't go down into a dark place just because my heart, physical heart, increases or decreases based on the year that I get tested.
Yeah.
And I just, my soul needs to be rooted in who God is and what His word says about me and the fact that this place here on earth is not our forever home.
Yeah.
Like, our hope is in the eternal life, not just the life that we've been given here on earth. So physically, that's kind of where I am again, and that's okay. Like, we come at peace knowing that whatever circumstances befalls us, we're going to be okay because of Jesus. We're going to be okay because of Christ.
Absolutely. But at times in our humanness and in this world, this temporary life that we live, I love somebody called it the pre-life, that this is
that's
the
good.
Pre-life.
I like that.
Yeah. It is, isn't it? But when you look at it that way, Julie, not many people, especially young people like the two of you with young children, have to face this kind of mortality. And it's hard. It's even hard to sit and talk with you because you're young and you know, we talk and we believe in that idea that you've got lots of time. Mm-hmm. But you have to face the reality. You don't know how much time you have. It becomes real every day for you.
It does. But I don't feel like my life is any different than someone else's. Because God, I mean, God's word says that he knows our days before the foundation of the earth. And so I want to live today as if it is my last, just like everyone else should be living their life today as if it is their last. And if it's not, then what a blessing that we get tomorrow. And even more a blessing if it's is our last day that we'll actually get to see Jesus face to face.
I mean, that is the key, and that's really what I knew would come from you. And I think it should be an encouragement to all of you, no matter what you're walking through, that God is with you. Mm-hmm. It's so easy in your circumstances to cast off your relationship with the Lord as if he's abandoned you. Mm-hmm. He has not.
Amen.
And, you know, the thing that I always reference when a young person is looking at life and death issues is that guess what? We're all going to go through that door. Mm-hmm. Nobody gets away from it. We all, like a funnel, lean in that direction. It just, for some, it may come early, and for others, it comes late. Mm-hmm. But we all go through that that threshold. Mm-hmm. And what I hear you say and what I read what you wrote, it's trust in God no matter your circumstances. Love the Lord and count each day a blessing. And in your case, literally, each breath. Mm-hmm. And that is beautiful. Thank you both for being with us.
Yeah. Thanks for having us.
And once more, our guests have been John and Julie Manning. And if you're in a spot, as Jim described, where you're really not sure about the next days, please give us a call here. We have caring Christian counselors on staff, and they can have a short phone conversation with you to kind of surface some of the main issues that you're dealing with, and then direct you to somebody in your own area that you can have an ongoing conversation with. 800-232-6459. And online, we're at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast. And you know, your financial support allows us to create programs like this to get hope out through the airwaves and to provide counselors and to offer resources like Julie's book, My Heart, Every Beat Surrendered to Our Unchanging God. And when you make a generous contribution of any amount today, we'll say thank you for your partnership by sending a copy of My Heart to you, and trust that you'll be able to find a lot of encouragement there. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for listening. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back next time as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.